Haunted House, Hauntworld fans, we're back again. Make sure you like and subscribe, and please leave comments. Let us know what you think in these next set of videos. These are videos that I made. They're called How to Create Your Own Haunted House, Part 1 and 2. I remember I was living with my grandma. We were literally boxing them up, mailing them out at the post office every day. And then we got picked up by a company called Johnson, and they had like a Things You Didn't Know Existed catalog. We sold them in there, and they just sold thousands. I mean, it was insane. It really was the beginning of my career of building haunted houses and attractions, dark rides, mini golfs, and everything else for other customers. The very first year I ever went to the Transworld show was 1994. Like, wow, look at all this cool stuff you can buy. And then later that year, we found that building. We built the darkness in the summer of 1994 and opened in October of 1994. And then the year after, we made the video from inside the original 1994 darkness. And that's the video you're gonna see right now. It's called How to Create Your Own Haunted House Part 1. And you're gonna see where a lot of ideas came from for the haunted house industry. They were through these pioneers, so to speak, who would share content with you. And that's John Denley and Rich Hamp, obviously myself, and many other people who would make this content and put it out there for people to have. A lot of things changed. And I'll tell you one of the things in this video, I'm gonna talk a lot about eliminating rail, talking about how you can go through scenes. And I'll never forget, and I was speaking to John Denley about this recently, putting Vaseline on your props. Because I remember like almost every haunted house in America had a scene and they would have a rail in front of it. You would walk by the rail and the actor would be on one side and the scene would be on the side with the actor and the customers would walk by it. And I hated that idea because I just didn't feel like it was real enough. So we might have been the first haunted house ever to not have rails. And I would have people at the trade shows ask me, hey Larry, don't people mess with your props if you don't have a rail? And I said, throw Vaseline on it. And then they get their hands on it and like, they'll never touch another thing in the haunt. And we actually did that. But I always wanted to like make props that you walk around that would send you into the room, and we still do that to this very day. So here you go, how to create your own haunted house, part one. You're learning a lot about the progression of this industry, which more haunts started becoming aware of Transworld and getting to know each other. And then through Hauntworld's Fright Forum, where it's like everybody came together and started trading ideas. And that's kind of where it all started. And here we go with one of their first legit how to create your own haunted house videos. How to create your own haunted house, part one, here we go. Kirchner, president of Halloween Productions of St. Louis, Missouri. You know, they call St. Louis, Missouri the haunted house capital of the world for the simple reason that there's a lot of haunted houses here. And right now I'm standing in the horror museum of the Darkness Haunted House. And you know, the Darkness was rated the best haunted house in the St. Louis area in the year 1994. And hopefully today, in this video, we will be able to share with you some of the secrets that made us so successful. So sit back and enjoy How to Create Your Own Haunted House. You know, before we get into any of the details of how to create your own haunted house, what we're gonna do is we're gonna give you a guided tour through a haunted house that Halloween Productions built and produced in the year 1993. It was called The House on Haunted Hill.
did you like your trip to the house in Haunted Hill? Like I said, that was voted the number one haunted house in the year 1993. And hopefully that beginning segment was able to give you an idea of what it takes to start from nothing, basically, and build a successful haunted house. Now we're going to take a trip through the Darkness Haunted House. The first year for the Darkness was 1994, and it was voted the number one haunted house in the year 1994. So here, have a look.
This is the location of the Darkness Haunted House. It's located in the old Welch Baby Carriage Factory. You know, the first thing we did when we were putting together a haunted house was draw up our plans. And of course, we had to submit them to the city, and they came back approved. Then we ordered in our material, our drywall, and our metal studs. And of course, we ordered in 2x4s and plywood and paint and screws and nails and just about everything else you can think of. Then we started the work. We grabbed our circular saws and got busy. As you can see, Mike here, he's building some metal frames. And then we erected those metal frames, as you see Terry screwing them together there. And let me give you a few tips on framing. There's impact areas. That's where, like say a wall behind a scene, you might want those to be wood studs, like here in this picture, because they're a lot stronger. As you can see over the entire haunted house, you can see now our framing's done. It's time to move on to other things like the electric. And of course our emergency lighting. And of course this gentleman right here will be putting it all together for us. Now you need props. And as you can see here, Jim's loading in a piano. Now we're bringing it into the scenes. Props are very, very important. They're like music to my ears. All sorts of things will make good props, like this fireplace. And to add a little detail to that fireplace, put some logs in there with an orange light, and possibly put some candle holders on top. This chair will make a nice prop. But to make the chair more scary, let's put a zombie in it. He's a little shy, but that's okay. That picture and that mirror will look nice somewhere in the haunted house. And so will this picture that I'm holding up. Those books look good on a bookshelf in some sort of library scene. Of course you need tombstones. And these masks will look really good on the actors once we get open. Our next step was to build a lobby for our haunted house. We wanted it to be something interesting, so we decided to build a type of horror museum. The first thing we did was put up our walls. And then we decided to build a concession stand. More of a souvenir stand, I should say. We'll sell t-shirts, keychains, and all sorts of other things. And now that our souvenir stand is done, it was time to add some detail to the museum. Here's Jim building some brick walls for our Dracula display. And there's Timmy putting some final touches on the walls. Later, I came in and spray painted it to look like this. And then eventually we'll put some posters on it. We'll move Dracula into a spot. And boy, does he look good. Next, we had to find some scary Hollywood props, like this predator. These big monsters need somewhere to stand. That's why we built these podiums for them to stand on. And as you can see, this pumpkin head looks really nice on that podium. The next thing we needed was some scary faces, not Jim's, but Vincent Price's. A few horror autographs will look good on the wall. And maybe a framed story out of a newspaper in your area about your haunted house. Man, that guy looks familiar. As we can see, Timmy's putting some final touches on the floor. We'll move Alien into his position. Pumpkinhead looks, he looks good right there. And now Jim thinks it's time to christen the museum. Done. Now we'll move on to some scenes. As you can see, we're building a type of living room scene here. Here's Jim walking through the Frankenstein scene. And there's Frankie laying around as usual. He's never any help. This guy looks like he's got real problems. This lady thinks she's a comedian. She's cracking up the place. Next thing we did was to build some gothic looking fences and gothic rails, as you can see here. You know, that moss, painted fire retardant, of course, will look real nice, and so will that gargoyle sitting on top of that pillar. Boy, does that look good. Here you are, some rails. These are the gothic forest type of rails. I'm putting a 1x2 on the top to add a little detail. Here they are, complete, painted and everything. And don't forget, when your haunted house is done, before you let the people in, clean up all the trash. This guy's laying around as usual. But it looks like he's trying to tell us something. What could it be? I think he's trying to say, it's time to turn on the lights. It's time to let the people in. But before you can do that, you've got to warm up the hot dogs. Hey, Steve, I'm a little hungry myself. Why don't you get me one? I like mine with mustard and relish. Hey, thanks, Steve. Oh, we better open the ticket window because the people are piling in. Wow, finally, the ticket booth is open. It's time to sell the tickets. So what we'll do is we'll take their money, we'll give them their tickets, and they'll be off into the darkness haunted house.
Who's there?
Grocery delivery.
Oh. Oh, come in. Set it down here on the counter. Yes. Care to stay a while?
Thank you.
after that trip through the House in Haunted Hill and the darkness, I had to take a seat. It was getting a little scary in here for me. Now, you're probably wondering why I'm not dressed up like some kind of ghoul trying to scare you. The reason I'm not trying to do that is because we're here to talk about the more important things of a haunted house. We'll get to the scares later. But the first and most important thing you need to realize when you want to put a haunted house together is your budget. Let's take a look.
When putting together your haunted house, there are seven things you need to consider when putting together your budget. Number one is location. Determine how much you're willing to spend on a location, and that will narrow down your search where to start looking. Construction. That has two phases. Number one, you need to buy materials, and number two, you need labor for the construction. Once you know the square footage of your haunted house, you should be able to determine the amount of money you will need for materials. Next is props. These are very important because these are the things that people will see and remember. Marketing. Without this, you won't be doing much business. First, determine how many people you want to go through the door and figure to spend at least $1 per person that you want to travel through your haunted house. Next is mechanical. That would be plumbing, if any, but more importantly, electrical. No business will be open without miscellaneous expenses. So figure in something a little extra to cover it. And last would be your operating expenses. The haunted house should be able to cover it from here on out. So good luck.
The next thing you want to keep in mind is location. Location is very, very important. Let's take a look at the key things to locating your haunted house.
Location is crucial if you're wanting to make big profits. Try to find something that could easily be located. There are two types of haunted houses. All or mostly outdoors. This would consist of hay rides or hornet forests and things like this. And then there are mostly indoor, which would be warehouses or real houses. Now, what to look for? Let me make a few suggestions. Number one, old warehouses. There are a ton of these laying around. Number two, open land, usually off the beaten track like a farm. Number three, try to find some property that no one else is able to use, but hey, you might be able to use it for your haunted house. And number four, don't try to kill yourself looking for a real house. Most of these are located in residential neighborhoods and you won't be able to get a permit. But most importantly, you have to find a location with available parking. If you don't have parking, you have big problems. So happy hunting.
Now we're going to talk about something real important. Where do you come up with your money to put your haunted house together? Let's talk about it.
If you don't have all the capital it takes to put you in the spook business, don't despair. I'm going to give you some tips. Number one, ask the property owner to invest. You're helping him find a use for his property. Number two, ask friends. They might even be able to help with the work. Number three, sell small amounts of the idea to a large amount of people. In other words, say if you need $10,000, sell 10 people on the idea for $1,000 each. Number four, ask yourself if you know someone that wants to invest in something that will make both you and him a lot of money. If you don't, put some feelers out there. Maybe somebody else will know somebody that wants to invest. And number five, a bank, not highly recommended. They probably will not invest. But most importantly, when you want to make your pitch, have every answer to every question. In other words, make your pitch with a plan.
So after you come up with your investors, the next step would be this.
Number one, contact area officials about the feasibility of putting a haunted house in the location that you have chosen. Find out what the building codes will be for your attraction. Hey, give the building division and fire marshal a tour through your location and show them what you want to do before you draw your plans. Next, submit your plans or blueprints so that you can get a building permit. Next, decide what materials you will need and order them so you can start the work. Other things you might want to do are contact the media, send out a press release, and start contacting companies you might want to advertise your haunted house with. Next, you might want to look into insurance for workmen's compensation and liability. Insurance is very, very important. The next thing you might want to do is try to find a printer. Start working on your logos and flyers and printing your tickets and things like this. Number nine would be security. I'll touch on that later. And don't forget to hang your blueprints somewhere where your whole crew can refer to them. Crew? Oh, that's right. The next thing is assemble a crew. Your crew will consist of the following. Number one would be construction workers. And remember, your friends will work cheaper up front and you can give them a bonus in the end. Number two would be electricians, licensed, of course, to do all of your electrical work. Number three, it's not a bad idea to start contacting a few security companies for when you get open. My suggestion, police. Contact your police department about the police working secondary for you. I'd rather have police working for me than anyone. Next, your haunted house is not built yet, but keep in mind that you will eventually need actors. Now, we need to talk about working with the building division and the fire marshals. You see, they will want to know what type of materials you plan on using and what type of fire protection is planned. Here are a few ideas about what to tell them. Number one, you definitely want to use plywood and 2x4s. Tell them you will paint all the exposed wood with fire retardant paint. Hey, number two, if they don't go for it, try to compromise. Go for a combo deal. Tell them you want to use some drywall and metal studs and some 2x4s and plywood for the impact areas. Impact areas are the parts of the mazing that will take the most abuse. Tell them that you should use 2x4s and plywood and you will paint them with fire retardant paint. Number three, we need to talk about rate of rise heat detectors versus smoke detectors. You want to use rate of rise heat detectors because they will not be set off by fog machines, and smoke detectors will. Convince them that rate of rise heat detectors are as good as smoke detectors in detecting a fire. But if they still don't feel comfortable with it, tell them for added protection you will equip each scene with a fire extinguisher and flashlight. The flashlight will help guide the customers through in case of emergency. Let me give you a clue. If you don't know or sound like you know what you're talking about, they probably won't listen to you. So good luck.
I've asked one of my friends here if he wouldn't stake himself out for a good position here. Maybe he could help me talk about the do's and don'ts of mazing. And I have this easel here, and hopefully we'll be able to draw a few pictures here and show you the do's and don'ts of mazing. Of course, you want your mazes to be at least 8 feet high and at least 3.5 to 4 feet wide. Now, refer to your plans. Your building commissioner might specify a certain width for the maze. Of course, you want to stick to that plan. Now, the don'ts of mazing. What you don't want to do when it comes to mazing is being able to, okay, here's the entrance. You don't want to be able to have, say, a customer stand right here and be able to see 3 to 4 scenes or even 2 scenes from one position. This is a big no. As you can see, we would follow our way through here, and if we were at this position, we'd be able to see this maze, and this maze. You totally lose the scares. It's very important to have some sort of sectioning in your mazing. Now, this is a do. This is a good maze. Now, you would come into this position right here. Basically, you would walk up, you come across, and you view the scene in this direction. Now, if you were right here, can you see any other scene? No, because this solid black line represents an 8 foot high wall. This black line represents a 9 feet high wall. As you can see, you are not able to see any scene, any other additional scene from one scene. If I'm standing in front of this scene, okay, I can't look this way and see another scene, or I can't look this way or this way and see a scene. This is very, very important. You can totally ruin the scares if you put scene to scene to scene without any kind of mazing in between the scenes. Now, you might say to yourself, hey Larry, you've broken your rule here. You have a scene on either side. Now, I'm going to tell you why this is done this way. Basically, as you can see, this is basically one big box. And this box represents a whole entire scene. What we've done here is we're escorting them right through the middle of the scene. So we're going to put a rail here. These dots represent rails. There's going to be a rail here and a rail here. And of course, this would be the exit of this level of the haunted house. Basically, they don't know which side the scare is going to come from. And that would be a do in the mazing area. I've asked Pumpkinhead here to help me with the next crucial part of a haunted house, and that is sound. Here again, I've drawn a picture for you because this is the best way to illustrate it. Basically, I'm going to save you a lot of money. I'm going to teach you how to use one receiver and get two separate sounds for your individual sound systems for your scenes. Basically, what you have here is you have a receiver. That's your receiver that you can buy from any sound stereo place. What you have is you have a left input and a right input. You have a left speaker and a right speaker. What you have here is you have tape one, tape two, speaker one, speaker two. And this is the trick to doing this. What you do is you come out of your tape one left side output into the left side input. You come out of tape two left side output into the right side input. Now you're probably thinking to yourself, what's going to happen here is the sound is going to mix and you're going to get some really screwed up sound. That's not the way it works. When it comes out of the speaker, whatever you put into the left side input is going to come out only to the left speaker. So the sound coming out of this tape is going into this receiver, coming out of the left side of the speaker, right into tape, speaker one. Then, same thing. Right side, out of the speaker, to speaker two, and basically you've bought yourself one receiver, two tape players, and two speakers, but with one receiver you're able to utilize it into two separate sounds. And that's the key to saving yourself some money when it comes to sound. Now we're going to talk about fog. Fog is very important to add atmosphere to your haunted house. Here again, I've drawn you a picture to try to show you exactly what I want you to do. What I want you to do is to buy an F100 fog machine. Most people buy six or seven of these little fog machines, but I'm going to show you how, if you buy one fog machine, you can use it to spread fog around your whole entire haunted house. What you do is you have fog machine. It sprays fog into a blower box. This blower box could be anything. It could be a plastic tub or any type of thing like that. Basically, what you have is you have a squirrel fan. Now, depending on how big your haunted house is, that will depend on how big of a squirrel fan you need. What happens is the fog gets blown into the box, it gets sucked up into the squirrel fan, and it goes through this drain tile, which is what we use, and it basically travels through the drain tile wherever the drain tile is. Basically, the way you divide it up and spread it all over the place is, so you have this straight line here going to scene one. Okay, we're going to get fog to scene one, we know that. How are we going to get fog to scene two? Well, we put this area right here, this is a T, and you can get this at your hardware store. Basically what it does, it'll separate the lines in three separate ways. Okay, of course we kept the extension going straight, and now we've added an extension on here and it's going to go this way. So basically the fog gets into this line here, and then it's going to travel to scene two. Now we need to get over here to scene three. So here again, we put another T on it, and the fog is going to get over here to scene three. Another important thing, let's say you want a little fog in your mazes. What you do is you cut little bitty holes in the drain tile. Believe me, the fog will get out, and that's fog. Having all those monsters standing behind me made me a little weary, so I had to take a seat, because right now we're going to talk about safety. Let's look at it.
Let me offer you a few safety tips. 17 to be exact. Number one, fire extinguishers. If I were you, I'd have one in each attendant area. Number two, flashlights. Give one to each employee. Number three, check the floors and areas that people could trip over, as demonstrated in this picture, and repair it. Number four, definitely have some sort of smoke detectors that will turn on your overhead lighting. Number five, paint exit arrows on the walls that point to the closest point of exit. Number six, have a PA system, something that can be heard throughout the entire house so that you can give instructions in case of emergency. Number seven, this is an option. Have a panic button system. This would be a button that an actor could press in case there was a problem in his area. That would alert you. Number eight, pocket doors. These are doors that recess into the wall, so in case of an emergency, these doors could be open like this. What they do is they get people out of the mazes a lot faster. Number nine, nails and screws laying on the floor or sticking out of the wall. Check carefully. This is an easy way for someone to get hurt. Number 10, check for splintered wood so someone doesn't cut themselves on it. Number 11, power tools. If you use them, be sure to check them every single night that the blade has not been put back on, and if it has, remove it. Number 12, check for weak walls and supports. Then re-support them. Don't let your walls fall on someone. Number 13, my favorite number, make repairs when needed. If there's a repair, make that repair immediately. Number 14, have good security. This will detract a lot of problems. Number 15, Communication is very important. If you are able to communicate with your workers, you will be able to better handle problems when they happen. Number 16, informed customers. Very important. Tell them the rules before they enter. Number 17, informed employees. They need to understand how to handle all possible situations, and they need to know your rules.
Keep in mind, safety is very, very important. Now, another very important part of your haunted house success is marketing. Now let's take a look at the marketing.
Marketing is crucial to any business' survival, including haunted houses. So I will offer some tips. Number one, without an advertising budget, you will not know where to begin. So that's first. If you have a small budget, the best bet is to go with flyers and discount coupons. Pay someone to hand them out in costume. If your budget is a little bigger, try radio. But don't spread too thin. Two or three radio stations will do fine. And remember, when you're buying radio, use stations that your target audience will be listening to, not what you listen to. Cable TV is also an option. It's a good one. And it's not too expensive. Again, advertise only on shows that will reach your audience. Network television shows can be extremely effective, but extremely expensive. I normally don't use it. But remember, nothing is as good as a scary reputation. That will bring in tons of business.
Let's add an extension on to the marketing plan. One of the easiest ways to market your haunted house and to make a little extra money is t-shirts. I happen to be wearing a House on Haunted Hill glow-in-the-dark orange t-shirts, because you can do these in a variety of different colors. I'm also wearing a Halloween Productions darkness jacket, and here, I guess, is a darkness t-shirt with the advertising on the back. This is a very easy way for you to make a little extra profit. And don't forget, you can set up a concession stand. Now, let's talk about another very important aspect of the haunted house business, managing your actors.
Other haunted house owners have told me that managing actors could put them in the grave. Well, I'm going to let you in on some secrets. Number one, remember, actors are more important than the scenes because they are the ones scaring all the people. So treat them like it. Number two, pay them bonuses. If you have a big night, well, make it worth their while. Show them that you appreciate them and pay them a bonus. Number three, have the best actor awards nightly and give away prizes. And get the prizes from the radio stations. You're spending quite a bit of money with them. They can give you some free CDs and things like this. Number four, make the pay escalate as the season goes on. Number five, rotate your actors around so they don't get bored of any one scene. And number six, have Halloween-related parties for your actors. Example, take all your actors out one evening to a current horror movie. And hey, let me tell you, have fun managing your actors.
Now we're going to talk about two very important aspects of your haunted house, the set design. We're going to talk about a couple techniques that you can use to really detail up your haunted house, and we're going to talk about where to find some of these unusual props.
Props are very, very important. We're talking about pictures, chandeliers, and things like this. And finding them is not always easy. I've given you five places that you might be able to look. Number one, garage sales. I personally don't like them and haven't had much luck there. Number two, junk stores. These are my favorite, and I believe that every city has one somewhere. Number three, flea markets. They're not bad, and I have found a lot of things there. Number four, antique stores. Sometimes they have cheaper things that might interest you. Number five, look in your own basement or a friend's basement. And remember, for those spooky props, the place you bought this tape might sell some. Set design. I could make a whole tape on set design, but since we don't have much time left, I will give you three detailed tips. Number one, bricks. The easiest and cheapest way to paint bricks is to take a big sponge and carve it out to what it would look like if it was a stone brick. Roll some paint on it, preferably gray paint, and press it on the wall to look like this. You can also make archways. Then, to add a special touch, a little three-dimensional touch, add something like this candle holder. Number two, backdrops. Backdrops are very nice, and you need an artist for this project. We prefer to use canvas, as the material because it can be rolled up, but the results are awesome, like this window and like this living room. Number 3, make some pillars. This will add a nice touch. First, start by buying some sonotubes like these. Then, cut them to meet your size specifications. Paint them with a gray spray paint, then for extra class, buy some Stonecraft. Spraying it on and it will look like this. Then maybe you might want to take your finished pillars and fit them into a gate as we are doing here. Adding some moss, sprayed fire retardant of course, and adding these gargoyles will really add a nice touch. And for an extra bonus, build something for the pillars to stand on, like these Gothic stands. And remember one important thing, that detail makes all the difference.
Now, the moment we've all been waiting for, the top 10 scares.
Before we go into any of the details on how to create the top 10 scares, let's review them. Number 1 are dark corners. Number 2 are dark mazes. Number 3 is a casket with the lid open. Number 4 is pop through the coffin. Number 5 is a statue effect. Number 6, the ghost scene with a distraction. Number 7, things overhead. Number 8, power tools. And number 9, my favorite, slamming door. And number 10, creative actors.
Now that we showed you our list of top 10 scares, old Drac up there told me if I didn't review them for you, then he'd take a bite out of me. So, we're going to review them. And you know, every time I start talking about these scary scenes, this mysterious fog seems to follow me around, but hopefully we'll be able to deal with that. One of the, or two of the most important scenes are dark corners and dark mazes. Now let me explain that to you. Okay, let's say here's your maze, as you can see here. If you can find something that'll cover it, of course that your fire marshal will agree with, and you can make this maze a little bit darker, and people have to feel their way through, that is very, very effective. Another thing is, like, say in this dark maze, if you happen to have an actor in all black of some kind, and he's hiding in the corner, the people only can expect that somewhere in this dark maze, somebody's gonna jump out at him and scare the living daylights out of him. Our third thing on our list was pop through the coffin. Of course, I'm not a very good artist, so I think we better look at some video of this.
Basically, the casket lid open scene is where the lid is shut and the actor opens the lid, and at the perfect moment, bam, he scares the people. Another way to do this scene is to have a dead guy like this on the open end of the coffin, and on the other end of the coffin, the guy, your actor, would open that lid and scare the people. See, this would be a distraction, and this will scare them every time. The next scene is the pop through the coffin. Let me explain this scene. What you do is you build a frame for which your coffin will sit on. Attach the coffin to the frame. Cut a hole in the bottom of the coffin. Then put a dead guy in the coffin. Keep in mind, his chest must open. Have your actor climb underneath, and voila! This will get them every time.
Number 5, the statue effect. The best way to show you how to do this is to draw you a picture. I'm not a very good artist, but I tried. What we got here is we got a mannequin, a female mannequin with a wedding dress on. And basically, let's say she's hanging about 4 feet in the air from the ceiling. She's suspended from the ceiling with like some sort of wires or something like that. And basically, she's floating. She appears to be floating. And what you have is, let's say you have 5 mannequin skeleton figures, all wearing like, say, Grim Reaper outfits with like glow-in-the-dark skeleton masks. And what you have is you have 5 of these. And of course, one of them, let's say this one, is basically in the same pose as the other 4. But of course, he's a real actor and he's going to strike. Now, let me give you a hint or two. What you do with this mannequin is turn his glow-in-the-dark mask a little bit towards the people, and as the people come through the scene, as they come by the scene, they're going to see him first, their eyes going to catch him, the mask is turned towards him, and everybody's going to think that he's the one that's going to jump out, but in reality, it's this one. Now, we're going to try to combine 2 scenes to get 1 good scare. Number 6, the ghost distraction scene. What we're going to do is we're going to try to teach you how to do the illusion effect, to try to get that, you know, that ghost into that plexiglass. We're going to try to show you how to do that and get a good scare out of it at the same time. Now, let me first show you how to do the ghost distract, the ghost part of it. What you do is, you have a piece of plexiglass, say, positioned here. And people will view this plexiglass from here. Basically, what you have to do is you have to have some sort of, say, skeleton. We'll use a skeleton as an example. And let's say he's hanging over here. And you want his illusion to be cast over here on this piece of plexiglass. What you do is, you paint everything inside this area right here completely black, from the top of the wall to the floor. The whole thing has to be black. Now, everything that is in this scene that's not black will show up on this piece of plexiglass. So that's why it's critical that everything needs to be black. What you do is you put your ghost here, your skeleton, let's say, and you put a light right here. Basically, it casts onto this black wall, and whatever, as I said, is not black will cast back onto this piece of plexiglass. And the people will be able to see the ghost and the plexiglass. Now, I'm going to teach you the best way to do this illusion scene. Now, what we've got here is the front of a house. Of course, I'm not an artist. But what you have is, let's try to add a little detail to your house. It could be put some siding on here and things like this. And what you have is you have some peeping Tom customers here. The way for them to see the illusion is to look through some windows that you build. So basically have two windows about 2 to 3 feet wide, and people have to really look inside the window to see this illusion on this plexiglass. Now, their focus is totally focused in on inside, looking inside these windows. And basically as they start to walk by, this is an extension to this scene. And basically, here again, everything inside this room is completely pitch black. And I guarantee you, when you're standing here, if you look this direction, the whole thing will look black, even though that this part is completely open. But when they see, when you have this piece of plexiglass here all black, and everything on the inside all black, and your actor is wearing all black, they will not be able to notice the fact that there is nothing covering this space. And as they walk by, I guarantee you their focus is still going to be on how did they do that over here. This actor will pop up and scare the living daylights out of them. Trust me, it'll work. Okay, the next best way to scare somebody is number 7, power tools. What kind of scenes can you have around a power tool? You could have some sort of mad doctor scene. You could have a crazy chainsaw man. Of course, you could have some sort of maniac tool man. Now, keep in mind, as we stated earlier, make sure that every night you check to make sure the blades are off the power tools. And moving on to number 8 is the overhead scene. Basically, before we take a look at the video on how this actually operates, let's take a look at how this is done. You have a ceiling and you have a floor, obviously. You have to build some sort of platform higher than the customer. Let's say it's about 6 to 7 feet high. What you do is you have a cable positioned into the ceiling, and basically it comes down to your wall. So basically the lowest point of this cable is 8 feet, and let's say the highest point is 12 feet. And basically what you have is you have your monster with some sort of pulley system that's attached to the monster running on the cable. And he's actually pushed out of, say, his cubby hole that he rests in at the customers. And of course, don't build it so that the monster will not go past the rail, which would be in the scene, say at this point. You don't want your customers grabbing your monster, or you don't want the monster hitting the customers. And let me tell you another way to get a good fright out of it. Get you a PA system. Believe me, this monster can be operated with one hand, with a microphone, and the other hand. So basically you have a PA system with the microphone plugged into the PA system, and you put your speaker down here pointing towards the customer. And now let's take a look at a little video of the overhead scene. Okay, we've taken a break from the studio to show you how the overhead scene works. We call this monster Slimer. And basically, there's wires that are connected to his frame, that are connected to a pulley, that are connected to a wire. Now, this wire is connected on that end, and it's connected on this end. Make sure the wire that's supporting this thing is on very, very strong. You don't want this thing falling on your customers or falling down, and you don't want it breaking or anything like that. Now basically, the way he works is when the customers come out, you make them say laugh or something like this, and basically you shoot them out. And it gets them every single time, trust me. Number 9, the slamming door scene, which is my favorite scene. It's the best way to scare somebody. Now you have to figure that you're going to try to camouflage or hide your actor in the set So he's able to jump out and startle them. The best way to do it is to build like a sub wall in front of the actual wall, and you have an actor behind the sub wall. And he's going to come storming out of the door. Now let's use a bathroom as an example. You have a bloodied up bathroom. Somebody's been accidentally wounded in the bathroom. You have a shower, a sink, and things like this. Basically, they're walking by the scene, and this door is supposed to look like it belongs in the scene. And basically, there's an actor behind there, and there's a hole in the door, and basically he's going to push the door with all his might. He's going to slam into this wooden wall, and it's going to make the loudest noise you've ever heard, and the actor is going to come running right at the customers, and this will work every single time. You can use this application in, say, like a cellar scene. You could have a cellar door. You could have all sorts of slamming doors, and they work. Now, the most important part of any haunted house is number 10 on our list, scary actors. Believe me, if your actors aren't scary, then you have no haunted house. No matter how good your haunted house is, 80% of your customers will complain if you don't have enough actors or good actors. So remember, scary and creative actors will win over customers every time. Now, that brings to conclusion how to create your own haunted house. And from Halloween Productions, we wish you happy hauntings.
So there you go, how to create your own haunted house part one. Yes, the footage is very grainy, it's very old. A lot of the ideas are very dated. And by the way, I looked much thinner, younger, more handsome. What can I say? Time flies, I guess, when you're getting scared. Thanks for watching the video. Leave a comment, tell us what you thought of it. What ideas in this video did you actually think still resonate today? That would be really interesting to hear. So once again, make sure you check out hauntworld.com, find haunted houses, stay scary, and we'll see you next time. Happy haunting.
For scary videos and more, subscribe to our YouTube page, hauntworld.com.